artist is very special to me. He and I met back in, John will know the day, the hour probably.
July
of 1986, when he was in Southern California participating in Disney's All-American College Band Program. And he came by my shop, and that really began a wonderful friendship. We created a lot of interesting trumpets together, and from there he went on to join the Marine Band in Washington, D.C., and on and on, and finally now playing in the Chicago Symphony. I can tell you, you will not meet a more focused, more caring person about what he does as a musician, his responsibility and how he fits into the orchestra. And it's such a treat for me to welcome him here, and I know you guys are gonna just love to hear what he has to say. So I'd like to welcome my friend and Yamaha performing artist, John Hagstrom.
Thank you very much. It's a big honor for me to be here. To be on the same program as Alan Vizzuti is mind-blowing for me. I'm no Alan Vizzuti, but I wanted to take the invitation anyway to give you the best of my observations about some different topics and some different ideas. And it's certainly not meant to supersede or to contradict or in any way make criticism of anyone or anything else. And so before I say anything, I'd like to encourage all of you to view whatever I say or to listen to it with a spirit of looking for common threads, for a common sense of how have I heard this before, maybe a slightly different way. Perhaps this fleshes out things I already know instead of looking for polarity in terms of, well, this is different and maybe this is what it should be and this wasn't. And I think that's a great way, just in general, to look for what is in unity and how can we find common ground. And so that's the spirit with which I say anything, and all the things that I've written is to give you those kinds of resources to collect and reinforce things you already know with perhaps additional information and more perspective coming from the observations I've made. Whether or not I'm a good trumpet player or a good orchestral player, I would say that I'm a good student. I'm very careful to observe very carefully of what's going on, what can I extract from how someone is doing something or what is important to them. And so I've always been that way. When I was a little kid, I'd watch the guy fix the dishwasher and try to figure out, I got to know how this dishwasher works, so in case it breaks again, maybe I can fix it, you know. So I have that kind of mentality for whatever reason. But as I've grown up as a trumpet player, I've become very much of an ongoing observer of people playing the trumpet and musicians in general, and just the whole phenomenon of what music does for us and what the power of it truly can be. I was sucked into playing the trumpet by watching Doc Severinsen play on The Tonight Show in 1973, probably, I think it was. And in those days, you remember The Tonight Show was out of New York, and Johnny would leave the show, sometimes 90-minute show, and at the end of the show, they would have Doc play often. And so I was so captivated by that, and the energy and the connection and just the pure, just the freight train of that kind of expressive intention was just a real magic moment for me as a very small kid. And so when the time came to play the trumpet, that's how I started. But going on from there, growing up in Chicago was just pure luck for me in terms of its proximity to the Chicago Symphony and the musical resource that provided. But I was very fortunate to just in my own town study with people who were subbing with the Chicago Symphony, who were world-class players themselves, and giving me, taking whatever interest I had and helping to kind of grow that curiosity into a bigger connection with music. And I've had a lot of very influential teachers, some of whom are people I've taken lessons with, and some of whom I've never met or really talked with to any significant degree, but I've watched them like just with incredible detail. And so, like Alan, I can go on and on. I wanna cover the topics that I've brought to your attention with this outline. And I'd ask you, if although there's a lot of articles in this book, please read them later, and please read them. But let's just focus on the first page. And I want to get to all these topics if it's possible. But if it's not, you'll know I've done my best to bring to you the most important ideas I can think of for an occasion like today. I also need to say something about Yamaha. In the same way that Alan had described, the experience of working with Yamaha has been transformational for me. They have attention to detail that is what accounts for the incredible consistency in the production of the instruments, but also incredible detail in the process through which the experiments take place to find the recipe that works. I have to say that in many ways the development of the artist model instruments mirrored the kind of work ethic involved with efficient and productive practicing. Is that you sort of isolate variables. You make decisions about what one particular change will bring, and then you keep that change if it seems to be helping, or you discard it if it's not, or you put it in a different configuration. And that mirrors in many ways what quality process can be in terms of its efficiency to help our own playing. I'm not going to try to bring to you any specific instruction of how to play the trumpet today. Because we all play the trumpet differently, there's a wide array of different kinds of targets for what we're trying to achieve in music and when with the trumpet and the particular context. My job as a trumpet player in the Chicago Symphony, I play second trumpet, which my job is to imitate and magnify someone else's musical choice in terms of when they play, the energy, the placement, the interpretive, whatever. My job is not to question it, but to absorb it completely and mimic it and get right up as wingman, you know, to support it without getting in its way, but without leaving it out hanging by itself. And the second trumpet player does that when it's working well, with great, I won't say ease, but with great agility. And my trumpet playing is set up to be able to do that in the context of what I have to do. I certainly enjoy playing trumpet solos, but my gifts really are in the sense of imitating and sort of being a relevant, hopefully relevant companion to another person's playing. I have made a solo CD if you want to follow that up. And you know, I can play solos. And I didn't bring a bunch of them to sell, but you can get it on Amazon or it is Music for Trumpet and Winds, and it's a CD with the DePaul Wind Ensemble. And I teach the trumpet also at DePaul University in Chicago and have a developing trumpet studio there. And so I'm very involved with education, and that's why you see such a sort of very precise kind of presentation here today. I don't want to squander my opportunity to have your attention and to connect with some specific ideas. I have to say one of the most influential things that had happened to me as a student was when Wynton Marsalis came to the Eastman School of Music when he was about to go on tour with the Eastman Wind Ensemble with the cornet record, or the Carnival record on CBS Masterworks. And so he was rehearsing for that, and he came into one of our classes, and it was our big chance to ask Wynton what he thought about different things. And so we really grilled him. And this was about 1988, being about the spring of 88, and all kinds of different things. And Wynton was kind of reluctant in certain to give really specific answers about certain kinds of ways that he played the cornet solos and the impressive techniques that he did. And someone even asked him, well, why don't you just tell us what you think? And he said, well, you have to find your own truth. And you find out what works for you. And it was an important moment for me because it impressed upon me the importance of becoming accountable, not just being a passive sort of obedient sort of recall machine for what someone else had said, but to be responsible to assemble information on my own. And as another thing he said that day that was very, kind of stuck with me for whatever reason, and he said this. He said, "Truth isn't truth until you're ready to hear it." And that made it, I probably had heard that before, but I was ready to hear that day. And to me, that meant that important ideas had already gone over my head because for some reason, I was focused on other things.